And as long as there's air at Hacksaw Jim Duggan's lungs, as long as there's blood pumping through my heart, I'll carry our flag, the flag of the United States of America, USA!
USA! USA! USA! USA!
USA!
USA!
The fans embraced Duggan as they always did, and so did the WWE. In 2011, Hacksaw Jim Duggan received the honor of a lifetime with induction into the WWE Hall of Fame. Longtime friend and old Mid-South running mate, the Million Dollar Man, Ted DiBiase, was on hand to do the honors.
You know what, folks? It's great to be with you here tonight. 1 year ago, I stood at this platform and myself was honored to be inducted into the Hall of Fame. And it was an unbelievable honor and privilege. But tonight, as far as I'm concerned, even a greater privilege to induct someone who not only is very deserving, but who has been a very close and dear friend for a very, very long time. But before I get to that, you know, as I remember last year, I closed out the Hall of Fame by raining money down on everybody to prove my point that everybody's got a price. So how fitting would it be if I did the same thing this year to kick off the Hall of Fame 2011? Yeah. How many of you want some of my money? How many? How's it feel to want? Like I said, everybody's got a price, and I just proved it again. But even if you don't agree with me on that point, I think you'd have to agree with me on this one, that there are some things that absolutely do have a price. The price of fame, the price of success and achievement all come at a very, very heavy price. The price of fame, especially. And the gentleman that I am inducting into the Hall of Fame tonight, he exemplifies all those characteristics: hard work, determination, passion, and a willingness to make all sacrifices necessary to achieve all the goals in his life. Jim Duggan was not only an exemplary superstar here in the WWE, but in high school, Jim Duggan was an athlete who competed in football, basketball, track, and wrestling. He was the first student in Glens Falls, New York history to win the heavyweight state wrestling championship. Upon graduation from high school, Jim was courted by colleges all over the United States to play football, and he chose SMU, Southern Methodist University in Texas, where upon graduating from college with a degree in sociology, he was drafted by the National Football League by the Atlanta Falcons. Now, when Jim got to the Atlanta Falcons, he was put on what I think was affectionately called the Suicide Squad, which was a kickoff team. And what that meant was when that whistle blows, you run down the field as hard and as fast as you can, and you look for somebody to take their head off. Jim Duggan has always had that kind of passion. Now, the first time I met Jim Duggan, well, it was back in 1981 when I was wrestling for Georgia Championship Wrestling. And in Carrollton, Georgia, we had a tag team match. My partner was a guy called Wildfire Tommy Rich. I was so overwhelmed, if you will, by Jim that night that I can't remember his partner's name. But I remember going out and getting in the ring, and when I locked up with him, it was like I'd been gripped by a vice grip. It was like I made it to the corner, the referee said break, where I walked to my corner, tagged Tommy Rich, and said, "He's all yours, pal, good luck." But again, Jim Duggan is that type of guy. He's go, go, go. I have been up and down the road with Jim Duggan almost my entire career. Another match that comes to mind was a match in Houston, Texas. We're tag team partners, and he got thrown to the floor and ran into a ring post where there was a bolt sticking out of that ring post that went into his head. And he's bleeding profusely, and the match is over. We go back to the dressing room. Now, there is a battle royal that still has to take place. Jim is so angry. He is so angry about this that he's stomping around the dressing room, screaming this one-word expletive that I won't tell you, over and over and over. But you see, they put this bandage on his head, and as he's stomping around the room, it keeps sliding up his head, and pretty soon he looks like a conehead. Now imagine Jim Duggan looking like a conehead stomping around the room. Well, all the guys started laughing. So Jim's like, "What are you laughing at?" I said, "Jim, take a look in the mirror." He took a look at the mirror and all the anger was gone. Jim started laughing at himself. And by the way, he went out and he competed in that battle royal. But the match that I think I remember the most that I had with Jim Duggan was in New Orleans at the Superdome. Now this match was the stipulation match of all stipulation matches. First stipulation, we were dressed in tuxedos. I don't have time to explain that. The second stipulation was that we were inside a steel cage. The third stipulation was that there was a coal miner's glove attached to a 10-foot pole in the corner of the ring, and the first guy that got it got to use it. And the final stipulation was loser leave town. That's a match I'll never forget. And I packed my bags and I went. But Jim Duggan has always been 110%. Go, 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 go. And he has fought long and hard. And I think that the passion that Jim has exhibited throughout his career was especially exhibited when he defeated the greatest opponent that he ever had. In 1994, Jim was diagnosed with kidney cancer, and Jim beat cancer. And he's here with us today. So ladies and gentlemen, without any further ado, I am proud and privileged to present to you 2011 Hall of Fame inductee, Hacksaw Jim Duggan. Folks, thank you. Thanks very much. Thanks very much. There we go, baby! Stay. It's a well-trained board. I've had it for a while, folks. But you know, it's been over 30 years since I became a professional wrestler, and who would have ever thought a chance meeting with Fritz Von Erich in Dallas, Texas, when I was being recruited by SMU, and he suggested maybe I could be a professional wrestler. And I was young and naive, and I said, no, I don't think so. I'm going to play ball. But after a couple of years and a couple of knee operations, I decided to give Fritz a call, and he graciously invited me down to the Sportatorium, where he opened the door to the strange and wonderful world of professional wrestling. Hey, thank you. That's, yeah. And you know, when I first started off, I tried Big Jim Duggan. You know, I was short hair, clean shaven. I had red and black trunks and a long gold bathrobe, which I thought was pretty catchy, but didn't seem to work too well. And then on a trip up to Glens Falls to visit my dad, who was chief of police up there, Arnie Skolin was with the old WWWF, and I was able to have a match at the Glens Falls Civic Center with Moose Morawski. And Arnie kind of took a liking to me and brought me down to TV in Pennsylvania, where the old WWE used to have their TV. And why down there, Ken Patera and Angelo Mosca stretched me. Jose Estrada and Johnny Rods put up with me. And Sergeant Slaughter and Stan Hansen helped me. And thank you. And one day, Arnie Skolin calls me in. He says, "Kid," he said, "you might have a future, but come up with something better than Big Jim and get rid of that gold bathrobe." So I got rid of the gold bathrobe and I went to Hawaii, where I worked with High Chief Peter Maivia in the Hawaiian territory. And I thought I'd try another deal. So I put a mask on and I wrestled as the convict. And I thought it was catchy, right? And so to be part more in character, I put little C's on my mask for the convict. And all the fans would say, "Why did you put those ears on your mask?" I said, "They're not ears, they're C's for the convict, you know?" And they kind of got a deal out of it. Then I finally left Hawaii, went to Georgia Championship Wrestling, where I met Ted DiBiase right here in Atlanta, Georgia. And of course, I still didn't have a clue what I was doing out there, and Teddy and a lot of the other guys put up with me. And I met one of my best friends, God bless Terry Gordy, with the Fabulous Freebirds, who is gone now. And then after a short time with Georgia Championship Wrestling, I went to Pensacola. Again, another character. I tried Wild Man Duggan, and I grew my beard real bushy, and I wore a fur with chains on it. And I would drop down on all fours on the way to the ring and do a bear crawl, which is probably the worst thing you can do back in the day, because you're at foot level and all the fans get a good kick at you, you know? But finally on to San Antonio, Texas for Joe Blanchard, where I evolved into Hacksaw Jim Duggan. And San Antonio was a tough territory, West Texas back in the day, and everybody had a state of the inn because we were our own security. We would all help each other back from the ring. We would all walk each other out to the car. And my mentor back then, Bruiser Brody, he came, yeah, Bruiser, big Bruiser. He came up to me and he said, "Kid, if you're going to carry something in the ring, carry something you can use. Forget the feathered boas and sequin robes." So the 2x4 was born. Ho! And it worked out great. I'd come through that dressing room door, was like part in the Red Sea. The fans would scatter, I'll tell you. They would take right off, man. Good. But after San Antonio, I got my first big break when I went to Mid-South Wrestling with Bill Watts. Again, I ran across my good friend Ted DiBiase, and we were part of the Rat Pack. And of course, Teddy being the guy he is, he ended up hooking up with Skandar Akbar and turning against America. And again, that was a big change in my life because I couldn't do that. And all of a sudden, I found myself carrying our flag all over the world. Ho! Thank you. And then, of course, something that changed my life.